Good afternoon, thank you. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Imelda Leila for inviting me. Originally as just a panel chair, but since last week you made me a presenter. But she's a friend from college days, so I cannot say no. But she's older than me by one decade. So my topic is regulation and oversight in local governance reform. If you look at regulation inside government, we can draw a distinction between primary regulation, which is exercised by the courts and the legislature, and secondary regulation, which is defined as oversight of bureaucracies by other public agencies. That's from Christopher Hood. So I'm taking off from a public administration, public management perspective. So I'm concerned in secondary regulation, which typically involves the following: information gathering, standard setting, and attempts to modify behavior. So I'm using this to contextualize my study or this presentation. And types of regulators include audit bodies, inspectorates, ombudsman, central agency regulators, departmental regulators of agencies, central government regulators of agencies, and central government regulators of local authorities. So I locate local governance, and what's important here was the passage or the legislation of the Local Government Code in 1991, where local government units receive a share of national government resources called the internal revenue allotment. And LGU functions and responsibilities include generating and managing local revenues, performing devolved functions, delivering social services, crafting and implementing local plans, programs, and projects, complying with the provisions of national laws, and exercising police powers. Over the years, the functions given to local governments have increased beyond what's indicated in the local government code. But of course, local governments are complaining that the resource transfers is not enough to actually accomplish all these functions. So the Commission on Audit has exclusive authority to define the scope of its audit and examination, establish techniques and methods required, therefore, and promulgate accounting and auditing rules and regulations, including those for the prevention and disallowance of irregular, unnecessary, excessive, extravagant, or unconscionable expenditures or uses of government funds and properties. Actually, if you attend a forum of mayors, governors, the COBA would always be part of the discussion, even though it's not the topic, because of the term disallowance. And of course, the Office of the Ombudsman. A report submitted by the Ombudsman's Finance and Management Information Office showed that for the year 2016, a total of 2,799 cases were filed against officials from the local government unit. So they are top. Number two is the Philippine National Police, which is supposed to be reporting also to local governments. And these are the other departments. So it means that there are plenty of issues to look at when it comes to regularity of behavior among local government units. And Dr. Lianto mentioned barangays, and barangays also, I think there are 800 cases filed with the Ombudsman. Oversight agencies on public finance management, because the problem here is the harmonization. Kaloy Abad-Santos is here, is NEDA, and local government units are considered the subnational units. They're supposed to be harmonizing their plans with national plans. But localizing the context of implementation, considering the problems in their respective local areas. But I think Akram mentioned the way political succession happens is about families. And but maybe you can comment later if the younger generations are studying more. But of course, they're using internet more and information and communications technology and social media especially. So joint memorandum circular number 2, series of 2016 was issued by the DILG, NEDA, Department of Finance, and Department of Budget and Management. Actually, this is a reissuance on November 18, 2016. It aims to provide better coordination and improve the quality of oversight agencies' technical assistance to LGUs, Public Financial Management, or PFM, and ensure that the different tools of the oversight agencies, including policy development, advice, guidance, manuals, issuances, awards, and others, complement each other. So we have to understand that within the context of decentralization, it's not just about local autonomy. It's also about the technical capacity that should be given to the subnational units. So it's as if you are multiplying the capacities at the national, regional, and down to the local level. But of course, there is an undercurrent I heard this from a forum of local government executives that it isn't this kind of diminution of autonomy if national government is imposing standards. But that's specifically the point about decentralization. There has to be a standard setting. So the next one is the oversight agencies on the business permit and license system discussed already by Gilbert. Joint Memorandum Circular Number 1, Series of 2016 was issued by the DILG, DTI, and DICT, Department of Information and Communications Technology. So this is what's different, because we are now bringing the Department of Information and Communications Technology. Well, that's simple because it was just created last year, the new agency. So the new memorandum circular is aimed at computerizing the process. So the standard, it will now become a minimum standard to have a computerized process. So the memorandum aims to disseminate a new set of service standards in processing business permits and licenses and guidelines to all cities and municipalities in streamlining the business permits and licensing system. Of course, the leaders here are the winners in the awards program of the Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry, the most business-friendly cities and provinces. I happen to be part of the board of judges in that process. Again, we have to consider that you have a number of champions, some organizations would call islands of good governance. Will we remain at that level or should we mainstream? So precisely, I'm now going to the DILG's, the effort to mainstream the process. Because prior to that, this was the city of good governance. You're familiar with the picture of the late Secretary Jesse Robredo. He introduced the concept of a seal of good housekeeping with just two criteria. A local government unit will get a seal of good housekeeping if, first, there is no adversarial report from the Commission on Audit, and second, if the local government unit is posting initially 14 documents, but now 17 financial documents and plans, expenditure reports that are needed to satisfy transparency. I had the privilege to engage the the late secretary in a conversation before, and basically he shared the idea that he wants to have, why just two simple criteria, although it's much more complex, it's really implementation. It's to have some kind of a bandwagon effect. So for the first time, there would be performance standards where local governments will actually abide with, because of the traditional notion that they are like kings and queens in their respective domains. And of course, the notion that they are elected. So their accountability is to the people and not to technical experts. But what Robredo here said is very revealing. Hindi lahat ng matino ay mahusay. At lalo namang hindi lahat ng mahusay ay matino. Ang dapat ay matino at mahusay. If you know, in elections, familiar with Philippine elections, candidates would say that I'm a good person. My parents would attest that I'm a good person, so please vote for me. So what Robredo was saying is not enough to be a good person. You need to have the skills. You need to study. And actually, there's a second part here that I was not able to put there, but he's also saying that you don't just need to be good in governance. You need to be good in politics. Because if you're just limited to one term, there are term limits of 3 years, then you cannot continue on with your reform. So you need to be winning. Good governance should win. Unfortunately, there are many examples of good governors who did not succeed in a second term because they're good. Because they studied well, and there was this young mayor who actually wanted to go home. I organized a forum. Young mayor, a political science graduate of UP, and then why are you in a hurry to go home? And he said, you know, because the next day the vice mayor might take over my position because a case might be filed with the ombudsman. So that's how the discourse happens. So it's really not about people being a source of continuity in terms of looking at performance. But what Robredo was emphasizing is that good governance is also underpinned by good education. Not just political education of the leaders, but the political education of the citizens. So the DILG, I mentioned the DTI, DOF, NEDA, but the DILG is the main oversight agency. And I will focus on the seal of good local governance. And the seal of good local governance is already the third phase of process of institutionalizing a performance management system. Because prior to that, before Robredo became secretary in 2010, what the DILG was implementing was called the local government performance management system. It's a checklist of 150 indicators. But the point here is that the LGPMS was a self-assessment. So lo and behold, all the local government executives were 90 and above. So ano sa UP yan? 1.0 yata sa UP yan. So walang gustong ibaksak yung sarili niya, di ba? So what Robredo introduced was a third-party assessment that involves the DILG. As you know, DILG had a hard time even suspending mayors, no? Even enforcing administrative suspension because when they go to the city hall, they will meet a barricade. No? People were crying, they wanted the mayor to stay, and then it will take, I think, a few days before the vice mayor will be put in the position. So the Seal of Good Local Governance is actually the next level, no? From the Seal of Good Housekeeping with only transparency criteria, the Seal of Good Local Governance incorporated other performance criteria, including good financial housekeeping, social protection, disaster preparedness. Now, the required criteria now is peace and order. DILG has a term for this. It used to be 3 plus 1, now it's 4 plus 1. The fourth required criteria that you have to pass, no, is the peace and order criteria. So it's 4, which is mandatory, good financial housekeeping, social protection, disaster preparedness, and peace and order. And the other, it's like the elective, no, yung elective mo, you can choose from business friendliness, environmental management, and they added another criteria, tourism, culture, and arts. So yun ang nadagdag, yung required na yung peace and order. Of course, you know why. Belda knows why. And tourism. Okay, what's good about this? It's tied up to performance grant. If you pass and you get the Seal of Good Local Governance, initially it's the Seal of Good Housekeeping, no? Then you get an opportunity to apply for a performance grant. But you need to submit a proposal. So many get the seal, but they don't get the grant because they had a hard time doing the proposal. So these are performance incentives. It's a performance challenge fund that is provided, and there is talk that they would like the Seal of Good Local Governance to be the requirement before accessing other types of conditional grants, even coming from the other agencies in the budget items of the other. So the coverage would be the entire the ecology of local government units except the barangays. So it will encompass 81 provinces, 145 cities, and 1,489 municipalities. So these are the requirements, you know, the good financial housekeeping, the compliance. Applying to the full disclosure policy, favorable COA audit report, and capacity to generate locally sourced revenue. So this is a list of those who passed the good financial housekeeping. It's quite small, but as you can see, by regions, in terms of percentage, the compliance is quite high already, 90%, except in our friend's region of ARRM, no? 20% lang yung passing. It's a good financial housekeeping pa yan. No? So, it appeared that Robredo's idea of a bandwagon effect came true. Nagkaroon ng bandwagon effect. Actually, required naman yan under the local government code, no? Except that upon ocular inspection, yung mga documents na supposed to be posted, nilagay nila sa bulletin board, pero may salamin, no? Nakasusi yung iba. Kaya hindi rin makita kung ano yung laman ng mga reports na pinost nila. The next one is disaster preparedness. So LGUs are required to establish a functioning local disaster risk reduction and management office. There are problems here because many cannot actually use their funds, or they cannot have enough funds to support personal services. So many are so-called job orders or contractual, or taken from other offices. For example, we went to some of the local government units heavily battered by Typhoon Yolanda, and one of those key cities actually had a disaster risk reduction management office that's populated by staff from the traffic management office. So apparently, hindi pa sila naka-transition from looking at disasters as just traffic accidents and not by storm surge. So yung mga nasa DRR nila, mga traffic enforcers, they are required to craft and implement local disaster risk reduction and management plans, as well as climate change adaptation plans. So the gaps can be seen here in terms of the preparedness rate. 41% in the entire Philippines, based on a disaster prepared audit undertaken by the BLGS. Why? Why is the preparedness rate below 50%? It's because there is a real gap in DRR planning, so the weakness in hazard assessment planning and budgeting. Because I during the height of one of these strong typhoons, one of the prominent mayors was on television and he said that, they can afford, no? We are really thinking of really being prepared. And we will procure fiberglass boats instead of the rubber boats. So the mentality is really about buying equipment rather than a judicious hazard assessment and planning undertaking that kind of process. So this is about social protection, so it deals with persons with disabilities, women, indigenous people, and children. So this is one, just one data, only 40% among 1,200 LGUs surveyed complied with accessibility laws or policies for people with disabilities. Peace and order, now they included a long list here. LGUs are mandated to craft and implement local peace and order action plans, sometimes called anti-criminality action plans, convening of local peace and order councils, activating anti-drug abuse councils, organizing barangay peacekeeping action teams, providing logistical support to the Philippine National Police, and logistical support to katarungan ng pambarangay. Now, with respect to business friendliness and competitiveness, these are the criteria. Streamline business permit and licensing system. Year-on-year increase of new and renewal of registration for business and establishment of a new office called the Local Investment Promotion Officer. So again, this is one office where they are having a hard time having a permanent person. So they take them from other offices. Sometimes the Department of Trade and Industry personnel in the region is asked by the city, especially if it's a big city, to occupy that position on a temporary basis. So this is a problem because it appears that provinces here are not really able to get their own revenues. No? Cities are quite better than the provinces and the municipalities. It's also because of the revenue powers. No? That's why talks about federalism might have to be reconfigured, why not congregate around cities rather than provinces? But apologies to my friends from the League of Provinces. But it's probably about metropolitanization that we have to go for, setting up metropolitan areas to address collective action problems that cannot be answered by individual local government units like environmental management, solid waste management, management of rivers, and others. Okay, I'm finished with this. So, there's a real problem in implementing local solid waste management plans for local government units. And this is based on the Ecological Solid Waste Management Act of 2000. Of course, there are infirmities in the law itself, because under the law, each local government unit is supposed to have a sanitary landfill. And certainly, many municipalities cannot actually afford it, as well as there are technical capacity issues with respect to waste characterization. So I think what is needed is really technical support, perhaps from the state universities and colleges, to provide chemists to help them in waste characterization. And this is what the DNR said, which is in charge of the National Solid Waste Management Commission, headed by DNR. Very low compliance with developing a 10-year solid waste management.
Wow.
Perhaps what should happen is the inter-NGO collaboration that is encouraged under the local government code but not mandated. So this is the new criteria, the tourism, culture, and arts, and some of the areas here is the presence of a local tourism office, tourism information desk, tracking system for tourism data, and cultural property inventory in the local government unit. So among those who passed the stricter set of standards, the Seal of Good Local Governance, it appears that provinces are much more able to meet the criteria, about 53%, while the other NGO levels are still finding a hard time meeting the criteria. So in terms of assessment structure, there is a three-stage process where you have a regional assessment team, a national validation team, and a national quality committee to look at the process. So CSOs and the private sector is also included. So what I would like to propose is some kind of a co-production scheme for monitoring. Co-production is the production of a service as contrasted to a good was difficult without active participation of those receiving the service. According to Ostrom, co-production was one way to which synergy would occur between what the government does and what citizens do. So an example of this might be the citizen participatory audit. An example, a pilot case. Of course, 20 years ago, there was the participatory audit in Abra with the support of the UNDP. This was the Bantay Lansangan Road Watch program in Abra, with the concerned citizens of Abra. But it was now resurrected because at the time, the Commission on Audit did not institutionalize the process. But now, what I understand is the Commission on Audit has accepted the program. So an example was the citizen participatory audit in Marikina City's barangay health centers in 2013. A community scorecard was used as a tool where the service providers and the beneficiaries were active participants in determining the quality of services received and provided against the standards. So, another thing I want to bring in is that under the good financial housekeeping scheme, local government units submit data that are now posted in the free disclosure policy portal of DILG. But in a conversation with Undersecretary Sir Panadero, he wanted traffic, so citizens should actually use the portal. So, in the context of open government, there is the supply of open data, but there has to be demand and use of the data. Just to share with you a small project that I led in a program called Making All Voices Count, Knowledge Partnerships for Open Government, where universities became information intermediaries in helping cities, local government units interpret, or especially the civil society organizations interpret the data. And this was done in Naga, Cagayan de Oro, and Iloilo with our partners from Ateneo. Magkasundo po kami ng Ateneo, Lasal Ateneo, at Central Philippine University, Xavier University in Cagayan de Oro. Just a last example here is Knowledge Hubs for Citizen Oversight. And what happened in Cagayan de Oro, city government established a local CSO office, basically institutionalizing the bottom-up budgeting process, the City Poverty Reduction Action Team. And the office, newly created office in Cagayan de Oro, under Mayor Oca Moreno, said that they would like to use the information portal developed by our friends from Xavier University, the Governance and Leadership Institute. So unintended effect, are what we wanted to do was for CSO, civil society, to be the ones using the analysis provided by Xavier University. But given that the portal is open, can be used by anybody, the local government units or the local government unit wanted to use the portal as well. So in a way, it's a leveling off. This is my last slide because my time is up. My recommendations are to expand performance-based fiscal transfers to further incentivize good local governance, assign expenditure functions based on local capacity, strengthen regional monitoring and evaluation systems, invest in technical assistance programs to enable LGUs to meet service standards, widen the scope of citizen participatory audits, and recognize the role of knowledge hubs to support citizen oversight mechanisms. Thank you very much.